We are almost ready to get started here. I'd like to welcome you in the name of the Lord. And even you guys in the balcony. They're waving. That's funny. Praise God. I would like to, before we get started, it's a secret, and therefore everybody knows. And that means it's Jaquel's birthday. Y'all ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jaquel. Happy birthday to you. Now, a little something we do on occasion to really embarrass you is to have a little birthday blessing. And so we're going to spend, we're going to take about six people. And if you want to raise your hand, and I will let you give a birthday blessing to her. Now, remember what a birthday blessing is. It's who the person is in Christ to you, who God has shown you, what they mean to you, how you love them, and so forth and so on. I think most of you know the drill. So if somebody wants to be the microphone passer around or person, and I don't have, we're almost up. Hello, hello. Is Frank back there? Frank's back there. There we go. All right. Who's first? You got to raise your hand. Jaquel? Not Jaquel. Jarena. Yeah. Oh, I do that so many times. I called you Jarena the other night, didn't I?
I think that he thinks we're twins or something.
Okay, we need her microphone. Jaquel. You got to put it right on your chin so we can hear you.
Oh, can you hear me now? Okay, so I'm not really sure what to say. She's a wonderful person, and she loves the Lord. And I had a vision of her just bright and shining like an angel. And I just believe she's a real light for Jesus Christ and a great inspiration to me to be more bold. Though she tells me she's not, but she really is. I've been out with her when we were prayer walking, and she's pretty bold. So she's just a really cool person, and I'm so glad she came to this church. And I don't know, just want to say I love you.
Mm-hmm. All right, who's next? Raise your hand.
Okay, I'll be next. I have just so thoroughly gotten, enjoyed getting to know you. You have just fit right into this body like you have always been a part of us. I am amazed at the revelation that the Lord gives you. Sometimes when you send us the things that you've written out that the Lord has shown you, it just is so encouraging. And I texted you just the other day, Jaquel has been bringing us our family dinner on Saturday nights, which is a huge blessing for us, especially on Proverbs days. But because I'm usually up here all day on Saturday, and we're busy in school, and Curtis is in the Word, and So usually Saturday night dinner is like cereal.
For the last 2.5 years, cereal.
Yeah, Saturday or night. Leftovers or popcorn or bologna, you know, and or it, you know, you have to pick something up on the way home, and it's usually the cheapest fast food that we can find. And so I just having you do that has been a huge blessing for us. And I mean there have been a lot of people in the congregation who have blessed us so amazingly over the years, but this has been huge, and we so appreciate you and Bob. And not only, I mean, it'd be one thing if you really, really bad cook, you know, but you are a really good cook, and she brings full-blown meals with, you know, salad and desserts, and I mean, it's huge, and I just thank you, and that that was something the Lord laid on your heart, and you just took up doing, and just to be that obedient. Just really do appreciate it. Your giftedness is amazing. Your just wealth of information and knowledge just in the natural is fun to be around and fun to hear all the things that you know. And I appreciate your just jumping in and helping with Proverbs, and you just have a servant's heart, and I appreciate that. It's serving without complaining. It's serving with an eye to to encourage. And I just thank you. Thank you for being here, for blessing Curtis and I and our family, particularly. But the blessing that you are to the church is just been invaluable. And so thank you for being here.
Okay, one last one, and I'll be the next guy to go. Okay, I guess, no. Jackie, would you open that front door, both front doors, so we get some air through here?
Jaquel, you have inspired me so much with the way that you are. You seek the Lord, you ask Him, you pursue Him. I remember one night in prayer that you were sharing about how that you, the Lord, you feel so much like you want to share the Lord and share the word and share all of this wonderful great news. And so you had asked the Lord what to do, and here you were, went to the park or wherever this was, and you, what do I do now? And then set up coffee and cookies or something. And I was just like, I was sitting there going, okay, yeah, I guess I should maybe do something like that too. But it inspired me to see somebody just move out in those situations and just proceed forward, of course, with the Lord, not on their own. And that has just really, really said a lot to me. And your vivaciousness, your exuberance every time you come, I just see the Lord just all over you. It's just so amazing to see that and watch that. And the way that He is knitting you into this body. And you just, like Jackie said, I mean, you just fit. And of course, the Lord showed you the people on the hill. I love that. That was so good. And your obedient heart to Him is just very encouraging. So bless you. I love you. Happy birthday.
Anyone else? Last call. Okay, I want to. I am absolutely thrilled, Jaquel, that God has sent you to be a part of us. I feel a spiritual connection to you that is deep. The light of the Lord and His countenance is all over you. You're like this beautiful golden butterfly in our midst that just exudes joy all over us, and peace and hope in our Lord. I see you as being a part of Christ, and I'm praying that you get integrated well with your brothers and sisters, because you're such a treasure, and I thank you so much for coming and being a part of us. Happy birthday.
I just had one more quick thing to say, too. When Curtis, you started coming when Curtis and I were in on our trip, and we were able to, I think it was one of the times that we were able to watch the service and be a part of it via the internet. And so we were watching, and you always kind of sit on this side of the church. And so during worship was going, we saw this long blonde-headed lady, you know, it's back in the, and we were going, who is that? Is that Tabitha? No, Tabitha doesn't have that color hair. And so we were trying to figure out who, that must be a visitor. And then you were just worshiping the Lord, and Curtis and I were like, we like her. I don't even know who this is, but we like her. And but I remember just seeing you, watching you worship the Lord as Curtis and I were worshiping Him too. And we just liked you. Couldn't see your face, didn't know anything about you, but.
This will just take a second, but first of all, you guys literally made me squirm because I just am so humbled, and you, I treasure each and every one of you, and it is a true fact. The Lord told me, I have given you this family. They are your family, and I'm just so tickled to be here, and each and every one of you really mean something to me, and I pray for each of you, and the Lord inspired me with this morning. Let me put on my glasses here. I said, I am 56 years old today, my birthday, the day he picked to give me life. This thought is what I was inspired by this morning. First of all, most of my life, my birthday represented a time that I would use as a reason to do whatsoever I wanted to do. It was, after all, my special day. What gave me the right to think that just because I had lasted another year, that this was all about me? I was sharing all this with the Lord as I was thanking him for another day of life this morning. Of all the things that we have to thank him for, we know that ultimately the gift of life is something that we will never fully understand the gravity of until we are standing in his presence on that great day. I was chosen to be born on this day because he desired it. This is true for every human born. I am not special. He is. This is not a reason for me to set myself on a pedestal, but every reason to exalt the Lord for considering me for his purpose. I am a nobody in this life. It is only when we are clothed in his righteousness that we become somebody. But the fact is, had he not called me into his glorious light, why in the world would I celebrate? Unless we have committed our whole life to the one who gave us breath, what would be the point? Without salvation, we are destined to an eternity cast out into utter darkness, forever separated from him, because we refuse to receive his love and be forgiven. So in light of this truth, I am going to spend this day, the day he deserves to be exalted, and say, thank you, Jesus, that you chose me to be part of your glorious purpose. This is why I was born on May 21st, 1958, because on this day, he saw fit to create me so that one day I would come around to understand his will for my life and receive the ultimate birthday present, eternity with Jesus. So, thank you for listening.
You know how you can tell a transparent woman before the Lord? She'll tell you her age. Oh, well, how about we pray and wade off into God's magnificent river of life, his word. Will you bow your hearts with me? Lord, we joyfully come to you and gleefully come to you, Lord. Lord, the water is running out from under your throne. And I ask you, Lord, to let it cast down upon us, just cascade after cascade and wave after wave of the pleasures of your presence through your word. So come and illuminate yourself, your glory, your greatness, your hope, your love, your heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 We have been in a study on sowing and reaping, and my goodness, this particular subject I think I could teach on for probably 3.5 years or 10 or 20. The reason being is because everything in our life is connected to what we sow and how we sow and the conditions of sowing. And in this session, we want to look at, this is our second session, on how God is sowing in us. Because when he sets a law, like he did in the book of Genesis, as long as there's day and night and sunshine and heat and rain and cold, there's going to be seed time and harvest. What he was setting down is that there's cause and effect. That cause and effect scientists use to make discoveries with. Here's the cause. You drop something in battery acid. Here's the effect. And so scientists use that in making discovery. Long before they made the discovery, God was trying to express to us his wisdom of the cause and effect. His determinate purpose, I think, is something that we need to look at. In Isaiah chapter 55, if you'll turn to that, or you can look up on the screen. Well, if you turn to it, that means you'd be facing the screen, right? As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. Did you catch what he just said? He's saying that he's the one that brings forth the rain. That's what comes out from under his throne. And it's going to produce, the pouring out of his word is going to produce, that's the seed, the word is the seed, it's going to produce something within us to where we can reap a harvest. Now, it presupposes that you will listen, you will learn, and you will make that your code of life. If you make that your code of life, of doing what he says in his magnificent, inscripturated word, then the transformation process begins in us. So God continues to sow into us a transformation process through his word. Now, John chapter 1 identifies Jesus as what? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And then we find out who that Word was. It was Jesus. Jesus was the Word himself. He came as the Word in flesh, so because we're flesh, so that the Word could come into our flesh and into our mind and into our heart. Now, what he did, he gave us the inscripturated Word from his standpoint of him being crowned emperor of the universe, and he put us under the law of the Spirit. The law of the Spirit. That's the law that we're under. We're supposed to live under the law of the Spirit. We're not under the law of the Jews. That was a contract for them to have the land. Jesus came to make a new covenant, and in that covenant is that we would be God's people, we would stand in his midst, that he would stand in our midst, that we finally we would be allowed in this covenant to become a part of God once again when man had not been a part of God. Now, do you think God hates himself? No. And if Jesus is in you, does he hate himself? He does not. Now, I want to, because we've got this thing. If I preach about the word and the don'ts, then we feel real bad. And then if I preach about the things that we're supposed to do, we feel worse. And we begin to feel condemned. But is the word for our redemption, or is it for our destruction? Now, who would say that it's for our destruction? Who would say that? The enemy would say his word is too hard. When he says don't murder somebody, well, what kind of God is that that would tell you not to murder somebody? I mean, he's such a weenie, you know? I mean, he might have had a good cause. If you were standing there, and let me give you one of those hypothetical questions. If you were standing there and could have stopped 60 million people from being murdered, wouldn't you have squeezed the trigger on Hitler before it all began? No, I would not. Why? Because God said, don't do that. And why? Because I want to be his pleasing child. I want to stand in his presence and know him and fellowship with him. And I want him to live in me. And Jesus would not go assassinate Hitler. That's not to say that Hitler wasn't finally finished off, and I am not any friend of Hitler's. My flesh man would have been ahead of you squeezing the trigger. My spirit man says, keep your eyes on God. You're in his army, and what are you involved in civilian affairs for? You realize the Lord says all this is civilian affairs. God's word has something it wants to accomplish here on earth and in us. It begins in us. I put in there, redemption or destruction. What's his word for? I would say both. He wants to destroy the works of the devil. His word is what identifies that and condemns it. It brings destruction to evil. Therefore, I have to set myself aside from evil. Then I come out from under the blanket of destruction. You understand that? There is destruction that's supposed to take place to evil, and that's reasonable. We want that. We don't want evil to go into the heavenlies. So we must turn loose of those things that are evil. Now, Here's the problem. If God begins to talk to us about those things that we do, I'm just so condemned. I'm such a louse. I'll never be anything. I can't come to you because I know I keep sinning and I can't keep from sinning. Is Jesus in you? Yeah. Then whose body is it that does the sin? Yours. But is there any sin in Jesus in you? Come on. There's not, is there? And who can sanctify the body if he's in us? And that's Jesus. And who was it that went and died for my sin? So who is it that speaks to me and tells me I'm condemned when God condemned him for my sin? Right? And if I want to take that responsibility and say, well, I'm just condemned, I'm saying his blood meant nothing, his death meant nothing, him suffering meant nothing. And matter of fact, it means that I'm probably going to have to endure God's wrath. Then why did he endure it on the cross? God turned his face away from him because of me. He turned his face away from him because of you. And all of everything that's within me that God despises and I despise went into him. And so the equation was answered and resolved that Jesus answers for all of those things and took the condemnation upon himself that I might live. Me as a part-time sinner. Yeah, I used to be a full-time sinner, but I try not to sin. I'm a part-time sinner now. Every one of us are part-time sinners. But that's not our full thing that we want to accomplish. We fall into it. We have our desires. We have our wants, our way. We're whiny sometime. We're angry sometime. We do all of those things, but it's not all the time. It's not all the time. And I would submit to you, it would be all the time if it were not for Jesus and his teachings and his word and his spirit dwelling within us. People of this world that like to toy with evil get worse and worse and worse at bickering, fighting, fussing, cursing, grumbling, grinding, hating, biting. They get worse and worse and they can't keep from it. And life gets more darker and darker, and they're just filled with spit, venom, and hate. I don't see you that way. I'm not that way, and it's not to say I don't become angry every once in a while. Jesus knew that about me, but he also knew that I loved him and would try to come away from those things. And keep in mind, we do things that make God angry, right? He says, in an outburst of anger, what did he do? I squished you with my big tennis shoe. Is that what it says? It says, I took my heel and ground you in the dirt and then asked you, are you okay? What did he do in his outburst of anger when I made him angry? I hid my face. I don't want to see that. That's what God does when you make him angry. He does not disown you. He does not throw you away. He does not condemn you. He just turns his face away for a moment. He said, but with everlasting loving kindness, I will have compassion upon you, says the Lord your Redeemer. That's who he is. He knows we're part-time sinners. But he also sees his Son within us and the Holy Spirit around us. And if you've received the Holy Spirit, then he sees a second member in there. And those two together can do their transforming process inside me that could not otherwise be done. Was that a word from the Lord? He said that his word comes down. And it's seed. There's just some seed. That was him speaking. Then he says, for this is like the days of Noah to me, when I swore that the waters of Noah would not flood the earth again. Listen to this. So I have sworn that I will not be angry with you. Angry with who? Angry with who? Can you say me? Satan always comes to you and tells you God is angry with you. How do we feel like we can plant a garden if God is angry? Because if I planted anything, it's not going to like it. He's probably going to send fire from heaven and consume it. And if I made him angry, the worms will probably eat it on the ground. If I made him angry, then his wrath is probably against me and I won't be able to raise anything anyway. What's the use? Why bother planting it? This is the way our human minds think, because someone behind the scene, the enemy, is making those accusations in our thought process. Remember, our fight's not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in high places. And the sword of God's word, that's Rhema, him speaking, will cut asunder the thought from the intent. I got a computer back there. It's got a thinker underneath the cabinet called a little processor. It just thinks. But the intent comes through the keyboard. And so the intent of Satan is to disappoint us in God and make us frightful of God. Not fearful, frightful. That you frighten me. You're always telling me you're going to mash me like an ant on earth. You're always telling me you're going to cut me off. That's not in Scripture. The enemies of God, yes. But are you an enemy of God? Because if Christ dwells in you, you are not an enemy of God. Does that mean that you disappoint? That means you do something wrong? Yes. But do you realize we cannot plant the good things that God sends us if we think he's hard? You remember the guy, all the guys with the different talents, one got 5 talents of gold, another one got 2 and 3, and the last one just got 1 talent. You really know how much a talent of gold is? It's a lot. 72 pounds of gold is 1 talent of gold. 72 pounds. Not ounces, pounds. That's an amazing amount of money. You could retire. Or you could do something for God. And my point is the man who received 1 talent buried it in the ground. And he made the statement to God, I knew you were a hard taskmaster. I knew that if I planted it and I did something with it, you'd come and take the profit. And you'd come and take it. That's not God's character. Every one of the other people received an abundance above what they had. Because they believed in God, that God was a good taskmaster. He was good. So that worker that believed that God wasn't a good taskmaster planted nothing and reaped nothing and gained nothing. So in our minds, the enemy is always trying to speak to us when we hear the word that it's too hard. If God says it's going to be light to us, if God said that his son is the word, that means Jesus is just too hard. You just make it too hard. You died for us and you expect too much for that thing of you dying for us. You ask too much for that thing of you dying for us. You think too much of yourself just because you took my shame. Just because you took God's anger, who do you think you are to want to control my life? Just because you saved it, who do you think you are? Can you hear the conflict in those words? But yet, that's what I meet and see in Christians all the time, that in our moral failures, in our spiritual failures, in us not keeping up with the rest of the crowd, in our minds, then we begin to condemn ourselves. But I'm suggesting to you the condemning doesn't come from you. It comes from Satan. Our fight's not against flesh and blood. If you're just a thinker in a computer, then Jesus is speaking to you through his word and telling you how much he loves you and telling you that the Father's anger is not upon you. He took that upon himself. He won't share that with you. Do you realize there's some things Jesus won't share? Isn't he stingy? He won't share his father's anger with me. He took it all upon himself. He won't share his father's wrath with me. He took it all upon himself. He won't share his father's hate with me. He took it upon himself. And he said, this is my portion. Isn't it ignorant of me to begin to think that I have a portion in those things when I have none, not from God, not from his hand, not from his heart, nor from his mind? He said, so I have sworn that I will not be angry with you, nor will I rebuke you. If you're his son, then he'll tell you, don't do that. But he will not get a stick and beat you. Why? Because you have free choice. He will turn his face if you decide that you want to do that unmentionable thing. He'll just turn his face. But for how long? How long? He's God, and he made the statement, but for a moment. How long is a moment? You think God knows what a moment is? 60 seconds is a moment. God will not turn his face from you permanently. And there again, the enemy wrestles your brain down and says, God's turned from you. In this, we stop sowing the good things because we get frustrated because the enemy is speaking to us. He goes on and says, for the mountains may be removed and the hills may shake, but my loving kindness will not be removed from you. And my covenant of peace, who's his covenant of peace? Who? Who's his covenant of peace? Jesus is his covenant of peace. It's not what I do. It's not what I say. It's not my actions. If I have faith in Jesus that you have done this for me, I have peace with God because Jesus is his peace and it's his covenant that he made with himself. And if Jesus is living in me, then he's in covenant with himself that my sin is covered, my shame is covered, my wickedness is covered, my evil is covered, my aggravation is covered, my anger is covered. Why? Because he's got a covenant. And then he said, my covenant of peace, Jesus is the covenant and the peace, will not be shaken. Jesus did not shake when he had to carry the cross. He looked forward to that day with great joy that he could take the sin of mankind away and reunite us with his Father. My covenant of peace will not be shaken. Now, why is it shaking in our thought process that we think God is rejecting us or we're not worthy or we're just some kind of miserable creature that's not usable? All those facts are false, are they not? If Jesus has qualified us to walk with our living God and walk with himself, whether I have a broken mind, whether I have a broken heart, whether I have anger flashes, if Jesus is in there, and he's the covenant of peace between him and the God, who am I to say that I'm not going to do what he says do? If you look at some of the prophets of old, some of those had some tempers. They would go deliver what God, and some of them had some fear. What did Elijah do after he had killed 400 prophets of Baal? He went and hid. If that's not being a coward, I don't know what is. I mean, if you called fire down out of heaven and it even licked up the rocks and you killed 400 of the prophets, then what would possess you in your heart to go hide because some woman says, I'm going to kill you by tomorrow? Now, I grant you, it was the spirit behind that, the spirit of Jezebel. But even so, he lost his faith and trust in God. But did God reject him? No, matter of fact, he set up a special meeting for Elijah. Elijah went out and he had a servant with him, and he became so discouraged. He went out in the desert and God caused a little bush to bloom and leaves to cover him. That quick, he just pops right out of the ground. He's down there, oh God, I'm dead. Why did you get me into this mess? No one's believed me. I've preached and talked your word. I've been stoned. I've been spit at. I've been cussed at. I've been reviled for you. Oh, God, now they want to kill me. Now, does that sound like a spiritual man? But God's spirit was upon him. So much so that it's still called the spirit of Elisha when Jesus shows up on the scene and John the Baptist is down there eating grasshoppers. Can you imagine looking up after being baptized and he has a grasshopper stuck in his tooth, you know? He was a man. And even as a man, there was some spirituality about him, but there was also a man there. But he still was able to be used of God even though he had a grasshopper stuck in his teeth. Now, you may not have a grasshopper stuck in your teeth, but you got some other things stuck inside you. And we often say, I'm not usable, Lord. I'm not usable. That's the enemy that speaks that. Because here's what God says. For the mountains may be removed and the hills may be shaken, but my loving kindness will not be removed from you. And my covenant of peace will not be shaken, says the Lord, who has compassion upon you. You see, the reason he has compassion is because he knows who we are and our failures and what's inside of us. Jesus makes this statement. See, we're constantly thinking that we're dirty. If we are, then we need to ask for forgiveness. And if we've got something we're doing that displeases him, we need to turn away from that. That's pretty simple. But that's not condemning. Jesus made the statement, you are already clean because of the word which I've spoken to you. What's the key to remaining in a good position of being constantly forgiven? Jesus speaking to us. That's one reason why we concentrate so much of becoming disciples so that we can begin to hear Jesus speak to us. Remember, it's the rhema, not the logos. He said it's the rhema, the sword, his word, and that word is used as rhema. That's someone standing there speaking. That's what's going to free me, Jesus speaking. I need a word from him. That's why a word of prophecy is like the inscripturated word. Did you realize that? And if you want to argue that point, all of Scripture was given by prophecy. All of it. And when did God stop speaking? He hasn't stopped speaking, has he? He'll continue to speak. So Jesus makes this statement that you're clean. Now keep in mind, when he made this statement, do you realize right after that the disciples were arguing who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? Two guys try to get the mother to get them to sit, and one on his left and one on his right. Does that sound like you're clean? That sounds like flesh and self, does it not? But Jesus still had them as his disciples and still made the statement, my word, you've been with me. My word has cleansed you. Now what needed to take place was transformation, and that came through them receiving the Spirit. Then renewal began of that which is up here, so that the carnal flesh man that cannot think on spiritual things was changed so that it could receive spiritual things, because there are no spiritual things within us. We cannot understand God. We cannot understand his terminology. We cannot understand his heaven. We cannot understand his instruction, let alone receive those, unless he bridges the gap and begins to speak to us with a spiritual mind for his transformation process to begin within us. He's the only one that has the Spirit, and he's willing to pour his Spirit out upon us to begin with, to cleanse us and to teach us his written word, so that then he can bring us into the infilling of the Spirit, so the Holy Spirit then can lead us. Now, Jesus makes the statement, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. The whole key to our constant washing and cleansing and forgiveness, not only that, but the key to our identity is that we have ourselves engrafted into him. If I'm engrafted into him, my roots of my old nature are cut off. And he's the one that has the roots that goes all the way back to the Father, is he not? I don't have those roots, but he does. So if I join in him, and that can only happen through the power of the Holy Spirit, then I can come into a position that I can begin to be fruitful. As a disciple of the Lord, God wants you to become fruitful in your relationship with him. And as you become fruitful in your relationship with him, that's the vertical relationship, then the horizontal relationships change into spiritual relationships. And those that don't want to change in spiritual relationships usually go elsewhere. Why? Because if you become a spiritual man, and you can't do that unless you stay in Jesus. Now, what do you think Jesus would be doing with his body if he was in this room right now? He'd be loving his Father. He would be expressing his word. He might do something for you, like get you a cup of cold water. He might talk to you about your frustration. If you have a problem at home that needs resolving, he might say, well, let me help you come and lay that carpet. Let me help you do this. Why? Because he really cares about everything about you. And so his nature exhibited through us, his character exhibited through us, that he wants to place within us is in that deposited mind of Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit and through the inscripturated word and through the revelational process of God speaking, Jesus speaking through the Holy Spirit. All those processes begin to transform us. I'm the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. And apart from me, you can do what? What's most of the church doing in the world today? They got lots of programs. Where's Jesus in the midst of that? We can do nothing except get flashy programs. What we need is Jesus in our presence where healing takes place. Jesus in our presence where words of knowledge, words of wisdom, words of prophecy come from his mouth. Why? Because in Isaiah, he said that it's his word that's going to be pouring down upon us. And that's what's going to produce that spiritual seed within us. So we need that activated in the body to let Jesus' voice come through an impure vessel. I'll never be a pure vessel. I can purge myself of some things so that I can be usable, but I will never, as long as I am in this body, never, never, never be a pure vessel. Although I try, although I listen to him, the closer I get to him, the more he can purify me. But will I have another thought that's not right? I will. But do I have confidence and faith in the promises that he made to Abraham and his seed, that he would walk with them and become their God? The children of Israel, oh my goodness, moaners, gripers, complainers, cursers, usurpers, killers, murderers, thieves, worshippers of other gods, and had their own priest of other gods right in the midst. Tried to take over God's tent. Tried to take over worship of God. Did God leave them? He did not. I haven't done anything like that. You haven't done anything like that. And you haven't done anything like Peter. Standing in the back of the courtyard, seeing the king of the universe, and somebody's pointing, he belonged to him, he's one of them. And that guy saying, God, blank this, know that, and brother, that, every four-letter word. So he could not be identified as a member of someone who was pure. He did that twice in front of everyone. It was he disqualified? Jesus had to go to him and convince him and get him past himself and give him a command, feed my sheep. I put the keys to the kingdom of heaven in your hands because you recognize that I am the Son of God. You recognize me as God. Your hearts thrilled me. You had faith. Your faith does all kinds of things and resolves the issue of your uselessness in the kingdom of God. Our faith is the only thing that we can sow back to God of, I trust you. I trust you. I'm just going to stay in the vine. I trust you, Lord. That's the only thing I have to sow in my relationship with Him, of giving Him my wretchedness. He identifies in Revelation chapter 3, and I'm going to paraphrase this. Don't you know you're blind, you're dumb, you're wretched, you're naked, you're pitiful, you're poor. And come and buy from me pure gold. Now, what do you have to come and buy from Him if you're that poor? What do you have? Sell yourself into slavery. Here's my body, Lord. I will become your slave. Can I buy that gold from you? When you become His servant and His slave, there's gold available for you that He will give you. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you. I have many people say, how do you get God to answer such prayers? I just abide with Him. And they're simple little prayers. I'm not on my face, oh God of heaven and earth, I need you to move. I don't pray like that. I just walk with Him gleefully and joyfully. And Lord, that needs to be done. He says, I'll do that. That's about the extent of the great powerful prayers that I have to pray. Why? Because if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish. Wasn't that a simple asking? And then what did He make the statement? He bound Himself. And it will be done for who? Oh, but you're disqualified. Can't be done for you. You know you're a dirty, rotten sinner. And it will be done for who? Me. God will do something for me, even though I am constantly disqualified. Do you need God to do something for you? Do you need Him to touch your mind, your heart? My Father is glorified by this. God is glorified. He's saying, I'm going to take this wretched vessel down here that is worth nothing, and I'm going to put my glory in it. You realize that really makes Him look good. You can take a wet paper sack and put the world's largest diamond in it. A paper sack that smells and kind of rotted on the outside. Put the world's largest diamond, hand-cut, glorified. It's got its own self-lighting system. Well, that's what they'd be like from heaven, right? What does it do for the paper sack? You don't even notice the paper sack, do you? That's what it's like for us to be filled with God and filled with the Spirit and to do things for Him and to realize, wow, You made this deposit within me. Oh, Lord, I'm not worthy of that. I know that. He often agrees with me when I tell Him how low I am. Yeah, that's who you are, but that's why I came. Oh, thank you, Lord. Because then it makes me more thankful and more appreciative for His abundant grace, His deep love for me, that He would constantly carry my shame. Why does He constantly have to carry it? Because I'm always trying to take it away from Him. Give me that. I'm ashamed. I can't approach God. He said, you sure you want to carry that? Because I died for that. Sorry, I'm not sharing your shame with you. I took your shame. I don't know if you thought about that? I mean, I'd be a little bit ticked off if I died on the cross and took somebody's shame and took my Father beating me and driving me in the ground like a nail. And then you come back to me and tell me that you're the one that's got shame. I'd be ticked off at you. Of course, you're lucky I'm not God. We'd have a few different rules, and there'd be a lot less people on the planet. The ones I didn't like, of course. Right? Right? You too. You too. My Father's glorified by this, that you bear much fruit. Where's the fruit come from? From Him. But I have to be attached to him, and the fruit will appear. And so prove to be my disciples. How are we proved to be his disciples? How do we know that we're his disciples? When the fruit begins to bear off of us. And that we're joined to the Father. And that we're abiding in him and abiding in his word. And one of the grandest things of why I know I belong to Jesus is because when I pray some silly little dumb prayer, it comes to pass. You're supposed to have confidence that God can answer prayers. Now, he has not answered my prayer, but I haven't prayed it for this big, huge boat. I haven't prayed that prayer. Although I'd love to have a boat, I haven't prayed that prayer. Pardon? Lisha wants me to pray that prayer. And I have to tell you, I have a lot in my heart that would desire that. But then I would have to pray for mountains of money because I had one guy that wanted to trade his 42-foot boat for my fifth wheel that I have. And I asked him, I said, have you ever taken your boat over to Friday Harbor? He said, yeah. And back? Yeah. Well, how much fuel did you use? He said, 50 to 100 gallons over there. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. I mean, that's like $500 for fuel one way. You know, I could get first class on the ferry for less than that. I could get the captain's hat. These things I have spoken to you so that my joy may be in you. What's supposed to be in you? His joy. And that your joy would be made full. He delights in giving us joy. And one of the joyful things that he does for us is to give us his precious instructions. You know, if I wanted to learn how to weld, which I used to know how to weld, but it's been so many years, I'm fixing to find out if I remember anything about that. That's what I'm afraid of. You know, I can remember burning a hole through my eye. It'll come back to me. Our God is amazing, but if I needed instructions, wouldn't it be silly of me to, now, how do you hold the rod? Well, you hold, don't tell me, I know. What, you think I'm some kind of idiot? Or you think I'm trying to, you're telling me the obvious. Well, I need his instructions if I'm going to learn that. And if I become angry about his instructions, it means there's pride within me. Sometimes it's just pride within us that we don't want to have to listen to those things in the Word that says, don't do that, would you? And in that pride, now our ears are hardened so that we can't remember and can't hear how much God loves us. It's not that God stopped loving us. It's just in our pride, our heart becomes hard and we can't feel his love. Then we will believe what the enemy has to say, that you're a dirty, rotten scoundrel. Every time I hear that, I agree quickly. Yes, I am. That's why I need Jesus. That's my response to that whenever I hear that. These things I have spoken to you so that my joy may be made full. Let's get on here. I've got a couple other passages of Scripture to show you. My word yields its, we've done, doesn't return to him empty. We did that. Let's go on. What does his word accomplish? All these things about his word accomplishes something. You'll go out with joy. See, you realize that's part of the continuation. So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what it is I desire and achieve the purpose for which I have sent it. Why did he send the word? That you'll go out with joy. And you'll be led forth with peace, and the mountains and hills before you, you'll be like Julie Andrews, and Sound of Music, singing that song with your arms and spinning around and looking at the heights of which God can carry you forth. Here's God's divine purposes for you, that you'll go out with joy. You'll be led forth in peace. And that the mountains and hills will burst into song before you. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. You know, I used to love it when I'd go up into Colorado because they had the little aspen trees up there. And I would feel the Lord's presence and I'd go up there and pray. And while I was praying, sometime I would look up because I'd usually pick a big rock in a river or by a river to sit in the rushing water and pray and seek God, sometime for days on end. And I'd look up and see the little aspens, and they'd be, there's one of God's kids. You, Scripture says all of nature groans and travails waiting for the adoption of the saints. And I caught this picture of their applause, not to me, but to God. Why? Because I'm loving on Him, and I'm caring for Him, and I'm desiring Him. All the trees of the field will clap their hands as one of God's children comes walking by. They'll cheer you. The wind blowing through the great pines when I used to be up in the high, high mountain, it was like a song of His voice floating through the air. It was like His peace, and it would cause my heart just to burst forth into song. It's supposed to be that way. That's His divine purpose of sending His Word. And that's what His Word will work and accomplish within us. But not only that, He says, if we listen to that Word, instead of the thorn brush, we'll grow the pine tree. I love the pine tree. I don't like thorn bushes too much. Anybody got thorn bushes you want to exchange? Because pine trees are, boy, fill the air with this fragrance smell. I love pine trees. And instead of briars, you know what briars are? We had some Texas briars. As a matter of fact, that crown that's around here somewhere with those 2.5-inch barbs on it is one of those Texas briars. Pull out a tree. They go 100 feet long up in these trees, and they 2- and 3-inch spikes, some of them longer. Instead of briars, the myrtle grow. Now, y'all aren't familiar up here in the Northwest with the myrtle. When the Texas heat hits and the grass wilts and the flowers fall over dead, the myrtle blooms. And it just keeps blooming. The hotter it gets, the more flowers it puts out. And it's beautiful. Beautiful. God is making a statement. Instead of the briars that you currently have that are digging into you, when things really get hot, I'll cause things to bloom in your life. This will be for the Lord a renowned. You know what that means? Him doing things for us like that, it causes His name to be glorified. Angels stand up and cheer. Man on earth, look and see. Oh my goodness, it's like everything that happens in your life is good. Why? God wants that. He left that for an everlasting sign which will not be destroyed. That if we walk with Him, we somehow appear that we have some supernatural blessing upon our life. It's called the stale peanut blessing. Somebody coined that phrase, and I absolutely love that phrase because God has given us so much, and sometimes something to be worth $10,000, and I said, well, all I got is $4.98. Sold! And so they told me, you buy everything for a stale peanut. You just go in there and offer them a stale peanut, and they'll take it. Well, yeah. And here's why. It's an everlasting sign of God's great name, of Him walking with me and being inside me and hearing the prayers that are within my heart. I'm not demanding those things. I'm not claiming those things. It's just His favor. And something I think we often forget because of our nature of sin and our failures is that He has promised to give us His favor. If His Son lives within inside you, He promises to give you His favor because there's a covenant of peace between Him and His Son. Reaping and sowing. If God can be for us, who can be against us? I would submit to you there's one person that's against you more than any other. It's me, myself, and I that listens to the enemy. He defeats me. He causes me to think so bad of myself that I don't want to plant. You can begin to feel so bad about God and things that you'll stop putting seeds in the ground and say, what's the use? What that is the enemy painting a picture in your mind that somehow God is hard, and he is not. He came to take away the hardness, beginning with the hardness of our heart. If he can take that hardness of the heart away, then we can see how good he is. Isaiah 26:3-4. You will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is steadfast on you, because he trusts you. Did you see the double seeds there? God's sending a seed of perfect peace. I'm sending a seed. I just trust you. Trust in the Lord forever. For the Lord is the rock eternal. He's the only thing that's solid in your life, and the enemy wants to rob it. How great is your goodness, which you have stored up for those who fear you. Do you fear him? I don't fear losing anything I own. It's not that kind of fear of, oh God, you're going to punish me if I don't do what you say. Can you see how wrong that thinking is? You're going to punish me if I don't do what you say. That's not fear. That's stupidity. Fear of God is understanding this is the King of the universe. I am an ant to him, and he cares about me. And since he's the King, shouldn't I have enough sense just to bow my knee? I mean, if the Queen of England came to visit us, every one of you would do what you do to a queen, and that's that you would bow on one knee, and you would do the etiquette that we're just supposed to pay homage to people that God had placed in power of kings and queens. I mean, he's the one that put that position in there for us. If we would do that to a human, if we would have reverence for him, how much more reverence should we have for a living God that allows us to breathe his air? How much more should we have for a living God that, what is it now? I'm 60, and 42 is when I had my heart attack, and 42 is when the Lord said the enemy required your life. They had a right to take it, but I have much for you to do. And he lifted me up and began to bring me back to life. 18 years beyond my time. 18 years. How great is your goodness, which you've stored up for those who fear you, which you bestow in the sight of men. God loves nothing more than bestow his goodness upon you in the sight of men. On those who take refuge, who does he put his goodness on? On those who take refuge. Did you see the counterbalance there? He gives the seed of giving to us, and he bestows his goodness upon us. What's the seed I give him that I'm going to be planting? You're my refuge. There's no place else to go. I don't want to go anywhere. I want to be just in you, O Lord. Can you see what I'm sowing in my relationship with him? And then what he's sowing in his relationship with me is the taste of his goodness. But only if I take refuge in him and trust him. In the shelter of your presence, you hide them from the intrigues of men. That means the pains, the enemies that we have. In your dwelling, you keep them safe from accusing tongues. And I can tell you, being one of the men of God, I have taken some real tongue lashings, but nothing like our Lord has. Last scripture. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken, but endures forever. Do you trust him? Because if you do, he says, I want you to get this picture. Jerusalem is surrounded by mountains. And as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. For how long? Do you tick him off? Does he surround you until you make him mad? Does he surround you until you stick your tongue out at him? Does he surround you when you don't do what he says and do what you know you're supposed to do? He still surrounds you, doesn't he? He still blessedly cares for you, loves you, desires for you to be in his presence. So our understanding and thinking about reaping and sowing, God is sowing much more towards us for this relationship than we are towards him. His word was given to us that we might begin to sow towards him in our trust, in our hope, and in our faith. Because when I see myself and the failures that are contained within this body, I'm overweight. Did y'all notice that? I sometimes weep because, Lord, I'm not even qualified to stand up and speak your name in front of people. This must be a shame to you. I really weep about that. And he says, it is, but would you speak? Yes, Lord, I will. In my brokenness, in my weakness, in my frailty, because that's a really sensitive area for me. I feel like I've failed my wife. I feel like I've failed you as a congregation. I feel like I've failed my God because I have not overcome and my weight. And I can tell you there are times I want to go hide in my disgrace and in my shame. And he says, I'm going to put my word in you. Go. I know you're ashamed. And I will speak through you and use you. Now surely, my sin goes before me. Your sin may be hidden. Surely, if he can use me in my condition, can't he use you and yours? He desires for you to trust him. That's one thing I do, is trust him. That's the greatest thing that you can do. I can remember when my little girls were this tall. My youngest one had the habit of wanting to ride on my shoulders. And then she got in the habit that she wanted to stand up on my shoulders. And I would hold her feet. And then she got in the habit that she would try to fall. Now, I was an extra strong young man. My little girl could never fall and never hit the ground. And she used to dive at it and try. She would lean completely over this way, and I would have her. She would not and could not fall. She had trust, so much trust, that she was testing it joyfully, going, wee, wee. And I held tight. I had the capacity to do such, and God has much greater capacity to hold you in his arms and let you go. We're filled with zeal all through the things of life that you will face. Be encouraged with your great God that loves you so much that he would wear your shame as his badge of honor and say, give me that. Stop wearing that. It belongs to him. Give it back to him. Let's bow our hearts before our Lord. Lord, we love you and thank you for your tender mercies and great grace towards us, and surrounding us with your loving word, the kindness and gentleness of your heart. Your kindness leads us to repentance. Not mushiness, but to repentance. So that we can be in your presence all the more. So you can take away our shame. Come and touch us, your people. And give us new hope in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The earth is full of His glory. prepare the way of the Lord. Hallelujah. I believe he's coming like he's never come before. And I believe he's going to fill stadiums with worshipers just to lift up the name of Jesus over the earth. Hallelujah.
Your mercy and love and
I hope you were able to connect with your Lord and make the trip in this marvelous journey that we have with Him. I pray that His heart enters your heart and that you have new trust in Him. Build that trust. Build your faith. Scripture gives us a command, build yourself up in your most holy faith. What that means is not believing for what I want, but believing in who He is and what He is doing. Trust Him. He is your God. God richly bless you. You're dismissed. If anybody needs prayer, I'd be glad to lay hands on you and pray for you. Before you go, can we pray for Terry?